I'm from Belgium.
Yeah, I'm from Belgium. I'm Finn and Bottom, so
Belgium. I'm Paulina, I'm from Poland.
Marvin and I'm from Belgium.
I'm Susanna and I'm from Spain.
I'm Jorge and I'm from Spain.
I'm Gennaro and I'm from England.
I'm Hannah and I'm from Belgium.
Also from Belgium, but mainly I'm from Europe, I think. Most of my political career I've been acting at a European level, which is the most interesting level at in politics, but also the level with the most impact to day-to-day's life, and especially of young people.
What should the city of the future look like in your opinion?
Thank you very much for the question, and I could give you like a lecture of an hour, because cities is something that really passionates me. Most of the people in the future will live in the city. Most of the problems we know have huge effects in the city. Think of climate change, but think of migration as well. Think of inequality. In the city you see that in the day-to-day life. But that means that our solutions are also within the city. And I want to express one word to combine everything together. The cities of the future, they need to be smart. They need to be smart in their solutions on transport. They need to be smart in their solutions on energy. It's the cities that should make their own energy and not take energy from the rest of the world. And that means, of course, renewable energy. And a city should be smart when you think of digital. If you, in the future, and there are already cities doing that, if you go and have a coffee, you could just connect to the internet, make your appointments, connect with the world. It should help you to organize your daily life. Smart is the way the cities of the future should be.
Will it be possible to aim for a city where people only can use public transport and from which private cars are banned completely?
Think about transport is leave the framework as we know it today. Today you have the vast majority of people using their car, maybe young people using their bicycle and more public transport, but we know by the time they get a little bit older, they all want a car. It's that frame that we need to change, and just not say it's not possible to have a car, but cars should be something that we share, not an individual car, but a car that we share. And then if you look to the city of the future, of course it should be mainly based on going by foot. Take your bike, take public transport, and share sustainable cars. And that means electric vehicles, for instance, but sharing them, not own them. Because it's very difficult to get every connections. The city of the future, the city of the future will also be very big. It will be difficult to have connection in every corner. And that's why you need, and that's a smart solution as well, you need to have a connection between every of these layers. But all of them should be sustainable. That's the condition.
Did the European Union take initiatives to stimulate the use of public transport and the bike in the member states? Is there financial support for the member states, for example, to improve the infrastructure, to organize cheaper and more efficient public transport?
Not barely enough. I consider the European Union to be too conservative on these issues. They always say, oh, we have to make sure that all sorts of transport are part of what we subsidize. And that means that in the past, when Europe is investing, they invest, yes, in public transport and interconnection. And yes, they invest in bike infrastructure, but not enough. And in politics, as in personal life, you can spend your euros only once. If you have 100 euros, you don't have 200 euros. So that's in political life as well. We have our budgets, we have billions of euros. What we need to do in the future is stop investing with our European money in airports, in roads, but connect them all to the idea of sustainability. So I think there's room for improvement at European level to really support sustainable transport.
Are there any specific action planned in the near future in Belgium to improve the organization of urban transport?
The same as my former, because yes, there are investments in public and urban transport, but there's a vast lack of real good views. And what is very important on the political area, that means it's not enough to just say we invest in all sorts of transport. You need to prioritize. That's what politicians are chosen for. Otherwise, you could leave it to the administration. No, it's the choices and the priorities. And in that sense, we need to prioritize in what we want in the future. If you look to the near future, if you look to the city of 2030 to 2050, then you need to make sure that the air quality, that the safety on the road, that the impact on climate change is zero. Zero, eh? Not a little bit, zero. That is what we have to strive for. And in that sense, we need to develop really smart, intelligent ways to transport ourselves. And one of these issues as well, that's why I'm so into the cities, is people should, of course, go and live closer to their work, to where they shop, to where they go and have their sports, and integrate that in your proximity is one of the issues as well.
They said that Belgians have a brick in their stomach, but in our opinion, we can keep on building like we have been doing over the last few decades. Will there be a change in the way we will build in the near future?
Start by saying something positive about Belgian people. The brick in the stomach, that's a good idea. You know why? Because in Belgium, that's part of the fact that when people go on pensions, stop working, they have their pensions, and pensions are not that high in this country as in many other countries. It's a part of your social security that you own your own house. So owning your own house, that's a good idea. But what's the problem with the brick in the stomach of the Belgian? It combines not only the wish to own your house, but also it needs to be, you know, that house which is in suburbia or in far from the city, standing alone with a nice garden around it. And I can understand that. But if you live in suburbia with your nice house and your garden around it, you at least need two cars for your family to go out and work and shop and school and whatever. So it's not a sustainable way of living. And we have to acknowledge one of the problems in Belgium. We have many problems, but one of them is that we have a very ugly country and a very, very bad urban planning. And that means we are living everywhere instead of live together, condense. That's a sustainable way. So in the future, it will not be possible for every single Belgian to own their own big house with a garden around it. But that's not bad news, you know. I myself, I live in the city center. I live in an apartment, and I love that. It's also you can have a very high quality of life, living a little bit smaller. And that means that you have to clean less, that means that you need less money to make sure that everything is working. So it is also a very practical way of living. But I have to say, we still have to convince the Belgian people, but you are the new generation, a lot of Belgians here, and maybe you can start rethinking the way you want to live.
What do passive houses look like? We already have strict regulations in Belgium. Are there a big difference between member states? How does the EU plan to put the same standards for all countries?
It looks, can look completely the same. You can have a single house, you can have apartments, you can have combined ways of construction. So it's especially, of course, about the way the materials are used, the way you hardly need any energy, and a good new passive house, that it's not only using almost no energy, but it's also producing energy to make sure that your washing machine is working, but also maybe of your neighbors and so on. So that's passive is a wrong word. It's a smart house, no? It's a smart apartment. And at the European level, what I think, there are different needs in Spain than in Norway, yeah, in Scandinavia or in Belgium. So give member states a lot of freedom in the way they build their houses, but we need to be very strict on the norms and on the energy efficiency and on the fact that the house of the future needs to be that smart house. So what Europe needs to do is set standards for everybody and then give the member state, but also the city, a lot of freedom in the way they use the standards.
On your website, we found an idea to create greener cities, public parks. What is this actually? Do you think this is a temporary phenomenon, or will this idea spread?
Quite sure that it's an idea that is rather powerful. Let me first say, of course, what you need as a priority in your cities of the future, in the city of the future, you need a lot of permanent parks and green spaces. The one is not sort of substitute for the other. The only way when people can find enough quality in urban life is that you combine smaller space to live in with a lot of space to sit, to enjoy, for children to play. Having said that, a city is always in transition. There's always things changing. Every time when I entered here, the Grand Place, I noticed already a new building. So I come here quite often. So you know everything is changing. And that means that sometimes for a period of time, you have open space that will eventually, there will be a new building or there will be shops or whatever. But not leave, why not use that space? I myself, as I said, I live in an apartment and I face now an open space that will not be used for the few years to come, but in the longer future there will be, I think, housing. And now the owner just made it, he locked it and nobody can enter that. And so it's an ugly open space and nobody can use that. Why not make it a park for the neighborhood for the time being? And that's the idea.
In Antwerp, all new flat roofs have to be green roofs. Is there already an increase detected? What possible effect does the city expect from this measure, and is it worth to spread all over the EU?
It's absolutely a strong idea, and just make the combination with the pop-up parks, and the combination with more green space ever. But at the same time, that will not be enough. Green roofs, they have the advantage that they clean your air, they're good for the climate, and they make the city more beautiful. And it's better for your water management, because one of the problems we haven't discussed yet, as I said, a lot of problems, inequality, climate change, but also water will be a problem of the future. We will lack water, and of course drinkable water, usable water, and these green roofs, they have the advantage that they give an answer to every single of these issues. So it's absolutely an idea that we need to spread in the rest of Europe.
Reading in European Union, and is it realistic and affordable?
Let me tell you that I hope one of you, or maybe all of you, or some of you, will decide at a moment of time to go into politics. Because we need young people, we need them very much. And if you go into politics, at least when I went into politics, it was a fast conviction, and it still is, you can achieve and everything is possible. So whether or not you want a European Union is whether you believe that it is possible. And I do know that if you look to the European Union as it is today, and the European Union I would wish us to have now and in the future, there's a big difference. Today the European Union is still dominated by the 28 member states. I'll give you one example which is quite actual and quite devastating, I have to say, that is everything that's happening in the Mediterranean. and the people dying in the sea. Let me give you an example that is in the middle of the newspapers. And it was yesterday a big European Council on migration. And
you were in Brussels yesterday.
You were in Brussels yesterday, so yeah. I'm quite angry, I have to say. Because everybody's looking at the European Union and saying, why do you not help? Why don't you do anything? But it's not up to the European Union, the Parliament and the Commission to give the two most important institutions of the European Union. They cannot do anything. It's the member states that have to decide to be solidar with each other, to invest enough money, to have a common asylum and migration politics, and they just refuse. So there's still a long way to go. But if I wouldn't believe that we can change, I would do something completely else with my life, because it's useless to try and change something if you do not believe you can change. But having said that, in politics, whether it's scale of a city as Antwerp or on the scale of the European Union, you always have to work together. You never can achieve something on your own. As a person or as a political party, you always need to make allies compromises. And that's the nice thing about politics, but sometimes that's rather difficult. And that's why sometimes it takes a lot of time before we move in the right direction.
What do you think about the decisions that European countries make about energy? For example, France and England are still investing in nuclear energy. In Poland, there are still a lot of coal-fired power plants. In Belgium, they are exploring the possibilities of fracking. Is it possible for Europe to create a general policy for all Union members?
Good, rather complex question. As the last question, this is quite the same. When you look to the competences, and the competences, they are described in the Treaty of the European Union. It's not as if, as a parliament, a European parliament, or as commission, we can decide, oh, now we are going to make policy on energy. You need to have the competences. The competences are not fully there. That means most of the energy competences are at the member state level. We do have some competences on internal market, on climate change. So there is, it's what we call shared competences, some at member states level and some at the level of the European Union. But your question on the nuclear, renewables, where they invest in, that's member state level. So we cannot say, I would want that, because I'm completely against nuclear energy, I'm completely against shale gas and fracking, but we don't have the competence at European level to say it's not possible. To make laws to say the only thing you can invest in is gas in combination with renewable energy, which would be the only good thing to do if you look to our climate responsibilities. Having said that, we are trying in Parliament and Commission to move ahead. And that's why Sefcovic, who is the commissioner responsible, made a communication on the energy union. And the good thing about that is that we try to say, look, let's look to the future, 2030 and 2050 again, what do we want to achieve? And in my opinion, we need to achieve that by 2050, in the whole of Europe, everything is related to renewable energy. So no more fossil fuels in our energy mix. You could say, yeah, that's not possible. Yeah, it's possible. It's absolutely possible. If we start investing now in everything, you know, the windmills, offshore windmills, and we connect them. And we make sure that in the south of Europe, we invest mainly in solar, because let's be honest, not every member state has the capacity to have and solar and wind and everything that has to do with the power of water and so on. So make a combination and a good policy. That's what we try to do now. But I have to say, at the same time, we cannot forbid member states to invest in nuclear, although it's not affordable. It's a silly project, because nuclear energy will always be more expensive than renewable energy.
Do you believe in the compact of energy neutral cities? By when would you be realistic?
to answer the second question, whether it's realistic to have energy neutral cities, they already exist. Okay, it's more of a prototype. But for instance, in the United Arab Emirates, nearby Abu Dhabi, there is already a city that is completely energy neutral, that goes on solar and all sorts of very intelligent energy systems. There's not yet anybody living there, except for a few students and a professor, because it's a prototype. But it's good that we have that sort of prototype, because the problem is not the technology. We have the technology. The problem is the political will to invest in these technologies and to implement them in our cities. And that's why prototypes are really very interesting. Of course, there's something completely different than building a new city in the desert, in this case, than trying to implement that in an old city like Antwerp or Paris or London or Warsaw. So there's a big difference, of course, but it's a little bit the same with where do you want to go with your transport system? Where do you want to go with your energy system as a whole? You have to define the goals of the future and then start implementing day by day. Every new house you build, every new apartment block you build in your cities, they should be part of that energy city. And as I said, they all should be smart. They should not use, but they should produce energy. And we're now into studying, for instance, wind energy. Because we all know the big wind farms, offshore but also onshore. But why not use small wind turbines connected to the walls or integrated into your buildings and use them? So it's, again, as I said in the beginning, it's related to intelligence and smart. And I do think, I'm quite sure, that in 10, 15 years' time from now, a lot of cities will already have improved, and instead of importing all the fossil fuels, gas and oil, to make sure that people can heat or cool themselves, we're quite able to make sure that it's completely renewable connected.
We noticed that there are many plans and ideas everywhere, but real action is moving very slowly. Europe gave Belgium some bad climate points. Why do you think that Belgium is one of the worst students in the class when it comes to reducing CO2?
Well, there are two main reasons why Belgium is performing really bad, as some other member states. The first is non-excusable, I think. It's the lack of political will. It's the fact that it's not a priority. It's a little bit what happened at the European level as a whole, but it's today a problem in Belgium, is we faced a huge financial crisis with a huge effect on our real economy. And instead of using that crisis to make a transition in your economy to a low-carbon economy, new products, we kind of had a very conservative reaction in many member states and also in Belgium by saying, this is not the time to change anything. Oh, this is certainly not the time to engage ourselves in an ambitious climate policy, which was stupid. The second is a little bit the construction of this country. This is a very complicated country. We have a federal level, we have regional levels. They, instead of working together, they always fight. And climate policy is, as you know, a policy that first of all needs to be tackled at a world level and then the European level. And in a country like Belgium, you need to cooperate on that. Some of the competences are regional, some of them are federal, some of them lies within the cities. And instead of moving all in the same direction, there's a continuous battle, who's responsible, who needs to invest, and the third, but that's also more of a general issue, I'm very much engaged into climate policy. I've been that for the last 20 years. But I have to say, it's very difficult to convince public opinion that it should be a priority.
And in political life, unfortunately, it's often the case that if the public is not interested, politicians do not follow, or the other way around. So we still need a lot of effort to convince people that climate policy should be one of the priorities. But again, I look to you as a new generation to solve that, together with me and others, of course.
Denmark got some good marks once more. 40% of their energy is from renewable sources. Copenhagen is very progressive. Why are they so successful?
To that question, why are they so successful? At least, I totally agree with you, they are very successful. And the good news is, they're not just successful on one level alone. They're very successful on the sustainability of their energy system. They're very successful on the sustainability of their climate policy. But they're also very successful on the sustainability of their social system. It's a very equal country, where people have a lot of opportunities in school, in high school, at the workplace, where as a parent, it's much easier to combine your work with your family life and raising your children than in a country like Belgium or a country like France. So they are, and that's good, because that means you do not have to say, okay, we invest now all our effort into climate and sustainability, but you can combine that. And it's even the other way around, because they combine a very strong social system with a very strong conviction on climate change, that their society is of such a high level. And it was on the news this morning again that if you look to the best places to live, they're always at the top, they're always the Scandinavian countries, because it's Denmark and Sweden and Norway. It's difficult to say, but there must be something in their blood. They're a little bit more intelligent than we are, I think. I always see difficulties if I try to explain the social system of Belgium, because we also have a very good social system, huh? Something to be very proud of. I experience, also amongst young people, but also amongst the generation of your parents and so on, that people are really angry with the fact that they pay so much taxes. You ask your parents, they will... my parents as well, and myself, and I can understand that. It's something that I can understand. But at the same time, maybe some of you can answer that question. Do you know in which European country, EU country, you pay less tax, the lowest amount of tax? Does anybody know that? It's Bulgaria. Well, in Bulgaria you pay like 25%. Taxes. In Belgium, it's more around 45-50%. Huh? And who of you would want to live in Bulgaria? So the level of your tax, and that's also the case in the Scandinavian countries, they have the level of tax of 50%. Huh? It's comparable to Belgium. Huh? So the best places on earth to live on, there's also a high level of tax, because that's the way you distribute your health. Huh? If you earn a lot, you have to pay more, but that goes into the school system, and that goes into your system on climate change. That goes. The difference between the Scandinavian and the Belgian system is that we are just not efficient enough with the tax money. And there I understand the criticism of people. So it's not about the level of tax, but how to use that efficient. With that tax level in Belgium, we could be as successful as the Scandinavian countries. And that's what I believe in. Not just lowering taxes for the sake of lowering taxes. The question is, what do you want to do with that? It's something to think about for you.
Van Lennart and some other famous Flemish people started the case against the Belgian government, the climate case. Nearly 7,000 people are joined this initiative. Do you think this is a step in the right direction? Will this encourage the government to take concrete action?
I do feel responsible myself. I'm almost a politician for almost 20 years, so I'm equally responsible as other politician for the state of the society in Europe and in together with a lot other political parties, other politicians as well. So So I do feel also responsible for the fact that we perform so badly in terms of climate and sustainable energy. But having said that, I'm really very happy that they did that. Because anything that can help to raise the awareness of climate, the awareness to do something about it, amongst politicians but also the public opinion, I'm supportive of. So it's a little bit, you see, it's a little bit double. And I hope there's also a court case in the Netherlands. They started that court case already. So then in the Netherlands you will have a verdict before we have some verdicts or whatever in Belgium. So I do hope that that there will be a sort of a conviction not to pay a fee or but to be able to raise the awareness. Climate, the change of our climate is together with the rise of inequality, the two major challenges we are all facing.
You were at the climate conference in Lima. Which measures have been taken that you can support? Should we be worried about our future or optimistic?
So I'm optimistic, but there's a lot of work to be done. A lot of work. And we are working now. I was in Lima, but Lima was sort of in between conference that we didn't take any decisions. The real conference is in Paris at the end of the year. And that's the conference where we need to agree upon real goals that every member state in the world needs to apply to. And it's a very difficult task to get there, because there's always the discussion. I think Europe, I have a lot of criticism on the lack of ambition in Europe, but having said that, Europe is the region in the world that that does the most for climate change. What we need to do is convince countries like the States, China, India, Argentina, to get equal ambition and to take up equal ambition in the course of Paris. And that will be difficult because we are an old country, old continent, where we already used, I think, most of the margin on the use of CO2. We had our industrialization. We had a lot of wealth. We still have. Countries like China or Argentina, they're moving up and trying to develop themselves economically. And to make sure that it's possible, they need a lot of energy. And that's why they use coal and nuclear and gas and oil and a lot of fossil fuels. So it's about who has to pay for what happened in the past and what are the engagements for the future. It's very complicated, and one of the issues that we really invest upon now is what we call climate diplomacy. Try to convince all the different states to engage themselves in ambitious goals. Let's hope we get there by the end of the year.
Thank you for the interview.